In April 2019, a gunman walked into a synagogue in Poway, California and opened fire. Panic reigned and people ran for cover as the man, equipped with what appeared to be an assault rifle, sprayed shots into the Chabad establishment. Four worshippers were hit, leaving one, a woman, lying motionless on the floor. Before we begin, make sure to smash that like button, subscribe to our channel, and click the notification bell for more amazing videos. Despite the chaos, Howard K., a doctor who'd been attending the service at the House of Worship, gave emergency help to the stricken woman. But there was to be a horrible surprise for him. And moreover, the outcome of that April day would leave the community he's part of reeling. Meanwhile, Oscar Stewart, an Iraq veteran from nearby Rancho Bernardo, took action on his own. He took off after the gunman, shouting at him. Stewart told UK newspaper The Guardian that he had frightened the shooter off. He said, "I yelled at him and he dropped his weapon and ran out. He looked scared." The gunman sprinted out of the synagogue and took off in his car. As he vanished from the scene, a security guard, who in his day worked jobs for the Border Patrol, took a few shots, striking the car. Not long afterwards, someone suspected to be the shooter rang 911 and told the dispatcher that he'd played part in the event at the synagogue. When he first founded the Chabad of Poway in 1986, Rabbi Yisrael Goldstein gathered his congregation in a storefront at the mall at Rancho Bernardo. But eventually, these meetings moved to today's center, built in 1997. This complex sprawls over 20,000 square feet and includes a preschool and meeting rooms. On the day of the shooting, the service had started at 11 a.m. and had been going on for about 20 minutes before the gunman walked in. Kitted out in military gear and wearing spectacles, he toted what the county sheriff Bill Gore described as an AR-15 style rifle. A witness said the man had been cursing when he began shooting. A person who'd been at the synagogue later told KGTV that the shooter had fired 6 or 7 times. The firing had set off screaming in the synagogue, but the gunman shot again. A newly arrived worshiper, Danny Almog, heard noises that he mistook for a dropping chandelier or smashing chairs. Once he heard screams of shooting, he hit the floor and scrambled to get to his children, who were in the playroom with as many as a dozen others. He could see that his father-in-law was protecting his son with his own body. Meanwhile, Almog searched in panic for his daughter. It turned out his buddy, Almog Peretz, had grabbed her along with some of the other children and had taken them to a house nearby to shelter. This had put him in the line of fire and shrapnel had wounded him in the leg. Despite Peretz's heroic actions, one child couldn't stay entirely safe, and pieces of shrapnel hit her in the face and leg. Noya Dahan, aged 8, had been at the service alongside her sisters. Her dad, Israel, expressed his anguish at the Daily Mail. He said, "We're shocked. It's a little bit scary. We're all over the place." The person responsible for this chaos was alleged to be a teenage man by the name of John T. Ernest, from Rancho Penasquitos, another suburb of San Diego. Ernest had not long graduated from high school and was studying nursing at a campus of California State University. The authorities confirmed that he had no criminal record, and there was nothing to suggest a link to white supremacists. The gunman had been unsuccessful in his attempt to make a live stream of the shooting on Facebook. However, someone signing his name had posted a letter full of hate speech online a short while before the attack. The letter that Ernest is thought to have written included some angry feelings about Jews. The writer claimed that he'd been inspired by a synagogue shooting in Pittsburgh and the previous month's attack on mosques in Christchurch, New Zealand. When he phoned 911, he's alleged to have told the dispatcher he had done the shooting because Jewish people are destroying the white race. Furthermore, the letter writer claimed responsibility for attempted arson at an Escondido mosque. 7 people had been inside the religious center when it was set alight in the early hours. Luckily, one had been awake and rallied the other 6 to help extinguish the fire. Whoever had caused the blaze had left a message that mentioned the New Zealand mosque murders. Whatever the truth of that, Ernest himself was apprehended by a cop who had heard about the incident over his radio. He'd been on his way to the synagogue when he got word and found the alleged shooter's car. On the cop's arrival, Ernest leapt from his vehicle with his hands raised. Unsurprisingly, the shooting shocked the community. Sheriff Gore explained to the San Diego Union-Tribune, "Sadly, we're seeing these things happen all over the country, and now even in our backyard." Meanwhile, Poway's mayor, Steve Vouse, told The Guardian that the shooter was someone with hate in their heart towards our Jewish community. One of those hit by the flying bullets had been the rabbi who had founded the synagogue, Israel Goldstein. He had been struck in both hands, badly hurting his index fingers. Despite surgery on his two digits, the rabbi would later lose one. However, he would be saved from worse. That's because one of the congregation leapt in front of the bullets as the rabbi was fired upon. The woman, whom friends identified as Lori Gilbert Kay, was struck down by the gunfire. She fell to the floor and lay there without moving. Help came quickly to hand, but it would prove too late. Then Iraq vet Oscar Stewart, who, as we've seen, had confronted the shooter, came to the woman's side to do CPR. But he soon realized that it was to no avail. In the confusion, though, and not knowing that Gilbert Kay had already passed, a doctor arrived to take over. Desperate to revive her, the doctor, Howard Kay, began CPR on the fallen woman. He had absolutely no idea that it was his own wife. He just put his skills into effect to try and save a life. However, as Stewart has realized, Gilbert Kay's life had already ended. And then Kay discovered who he'd been working on. First, Kay noted that the woman who had been shot was no longer breathing, still not recognizing who she was. But when he attempted to find a pulse on Gilbert Kay, he discovered that it was his wife. That realization proved to be more than the doctor could bear in the moment. Kay fell into a faint, stricken by the shock of seeing his wife fatally shot in front of him. Later, he could take comfort that she had passed very rapidly and without suffering. He told attendees at her funeral, "She went straight up, and right now, that's where she is." Goldstein described the scene to the New York Post. He said, "Kay was lying on the floor next to his wife, and then the daughter comes out screaming. It was the most heart-wrenching sight I've ever seen." The rabbi, unsurprisingly, remembered Gilbert Kay with a great deal of gratitude, since she had arguably saved his life. Goldstein told the Daily Mail, "Lori took the bullet for all of us. She didn't deserve to die." And remembering Gilbert Kay, he paid her a fine tribute, expressing what he felt about her. He continued, "She was the kindest person I've ever known, and the community has ever known. We're in such shock." Indeed, the rabbi lauded his brave savior as the ultimate woman of kindness. He told Brian Stelter of CNN that he had known Gilbert Kay for more than 25 years. He said, "She was one of the pioneering members of our congregation. She's not just a member, she's an activist." Goldstein even said that he owed the existence of the synagogue to Gilbert Kay. He wrote to the New York Post, "It's because of her that we could build this building." He went on to explain, "When we bought our property and we needed a construction loan, she was working at Wells Fargo and she went to the top to secure us a loan so we could build our community." Gilbert Kay's generosity didn't end there. The rabbi explained to the Daily Mail, "She's one of those people who are always there to be able to help others in their time of need." He said, "When people are diagnosed with cancer, she'd be dragging them to appointments and would bring flowers to cheer people up and bake Shabbat challah just to bring the family some happiness." Some of those who have been left mourning Gilbert Kay is her daughter Hannah. Just 22, she had wed only 2 weeks before. Chana Goldstein, the sister-in-law of the synagogue's rabbi, told the New York Post, "We were dancing with her 2 weeks ago. It's no surprise that a friend reported that both Hannah and her father were left devastated." Because the service of the day was Yizkor, Gilbert Kay had intended to say the Kaddish for her mother. She had passed in November 2018, and it's normal to say the prayer for a deceased loved one for 11 months after their passing. For Jews, it's a way to celebrate God in spite of their recent loss. Gilbert Kay's friend, Ranit Lev, a hospital doctor, hailed her as a people person and remembered how she would do good for others. God picked her to die to send a message because she's such an incredible person, Lev claimed to the San Diego Union-Tribune. He took her for a higher purpose to send this message to fight anti-Semitism. Lev told CNN that she did not believe Gilbert Kay's death had been senseless. She said, "She died advertising the problem we have with anti-Semitism and to bring good to this world." She then added her personal feelings about the fallen woman, saying, "If God put an angel on this planet, it would have been Lori." Despite the tragedy of Gilbert Kay's loss, it was fortunate that she proved the only fatality. Authorities have said that the gunman's weapon may have jammed when he shot at the worshippers. Indeed, that may well have been the reason that he didn't kill more. The alleged shooter, Ernest, may himself face death by execution should he be found guilty of the crime. Talking about the day, Rabbi Goldstein urged change. He told CBS News, "We have lost our soul." Meanwhile, Manu Anvari, whose husband has been present at the shooting, had a defiant message for the San Diego Union-Tribune. She said, One message from all of us in our congregation is that we are standing together. We're getting stronger. Never again. You can't break us. We're strong.